All right, are we good to go? All right, thanks for coming on a Saturday morning. I mean, it's tough to come because I used to attend such kind of events a year back. But yeah, so I'm from Delhi. So I came to Bangalore last year. So I'm currently working as a platform engineer at Postman. So Bangalore is kind of new to me and the communities as well. So before this, I used to be an event organizer at GDG New Delhi, and I'm currently leading the chapter of Women Who Go Delhi. So it's a kind of chapter which empowers women in technology, and it's run by Google itself. But yeah, its name is Women Who Go. All right. So today's topic is context API. So how many of you have, how many of you are beginner to Go? Right, and how many of you are using Go in your professional life? All right, quite much. Okay, so how many of you have heard about context before? Almost everyone. Yeah. Okay, so just an open discussion of anyone, want to tell what is context into just a single line statement on how you are using context in your organization or in your personal projects. Anyone? I mean, most of you are using.
Usually for timeouts and deadlines.
Yeah.
So if I've got a incoming request for instant timeout, then maximum it takes 1 second for processing
that. Yeah, makes sense. That's the whole crux of today. But those of you who don't know about context, it would be a very great and a fun thing to learn about. So starting with this, so my title is Flowing with Context. So it's a sort of hidden thing inside this whole sentence. I mean, if you listen properly throughout the presentation, you will get to know why I use the flowing word in my presentation title. So starting with this. Okay. So if I talk about context, things can go wrong because different people have different opinions about context. It's not a single thing which everyone follows across the industry. Some find it bad, some find it good. So views are my personal. I am not here to I don't want to encourage use Go, context in Go, and I don't want to discourage also. So it's totally up to you what you get from this. I'll just explain how my experience have been with context and what things I have explored in context. And then we can have an open discussion and we can have views from everyone about the context. Okay. All right. What is context? I mean, don't think about technology, don't think about programming language. What is the context in a real life? Anyone? This can be very interesting. What is the context?
Meaning?
Meaning? Yeah. What gives it meaning? Anyone?
The situation around you.
Yeah, the situation. The circumstances can structure something which can influence something. That's the basic purpose of a context. And if we don't have context in our own life, then we can miss out major things. I mean, if you look at maybe if you don't have context about this Go meetup, you won't have a broader vision to what you are going to achieve today or why are you coming today. So context directly and indirectly influences your actions. Okay. All right. How many of you can decode this? How many of you have seen Avengers? Avengers fans? Very few. I mean, you guys can tell this since you have the context. Anyone? Anyone? Okay, ignore this one. Look at the other three. This Thanos must come into your mind. That.
I have not seen it.
All right. I mean, those. I think more, at least few of you must have decoded this. I mean, who have seen Avengers.
The first game is a Star Lord.
Ignore the first one in this immense. Just the yeah, there's a kind of major population and the disappearing one. Alright. It's kind of very vague, but yeah, this is something without context, but still those of you have the context can decode it. Okay. So if you have the context, it can influence your actions. Okay. Another one. Stranger Things fan? Can you go?
I'm changing the three.
Okay. Even I have not seen. So I was not able to decode this. It's as simple as that. If you don't have the context, you cannot learn from things. You cannot interpret things. You cannot make your actions and decisions from that. That's the basic agenda of context in a real life. All right. Okay. From real life perspective, I have a very interesting example to tell. The first is the better decision. So for example, maybe you are watching a stand-up comedian. All right. He makes a joke. And after a few more sentences, he makes the reference and the context to the first joke he made. Okay. You will laugh only if you know the context. Okay. It is, so it's sort of a decision. I mean, it's a subconscious decision that is made by you to laugh, which depends on the context. Okay. So that's how a context can influence decisions in real life. And we'll see how it influences decision in the technical or the programmatical world as well. No wastage of resources. Okay. So think if I have to book an Uber and as usual, we don't get Uber. I'm just trying in Bangalore particularly. I'm just trying to book an Uber. I'm not getting it. So I tell a person, can you book an Uber for me? And at the same time, I told you as well, can you book an Uber for me? Because no one else was getting. And they both don't have the link. I mean, the in-between link that they are doing a work for me. All right. Maybe he does that and he was not informed. Okay. And he booked a Uber and paid the money. Okay. And the same thing was happened at that side also. So actually, since he has no context of what was going on the other side, he don't know what step to be taken, what things to be done. Okay. So this was a wastage of resources for all of us, for me as well. All right. So that's how, if you don't have the context, you can lose your resources as well in real life as well. Shared entities, not leaked. So this is sort of a very deep thing inside context that, for example, if I gave him $100, that please book an Uber for me. This guy doesn't know that I gave him the $100. Okay. So if context is need to be used very carefully, it should be used when you have to propagate flows, not the entities which are very important. Okay. So you cannot share everything with everyone. Okay. The context needs to be shared very carefully with everyone where you want to inform decisions which needs to be propagated throughout everyone which are nearby or where we want to propagate that. Okay. I hope these 3 points make sense. Anyone, any doubt till here? The general concepts? Okay. From the applications perspective, okay. Request scope values. This is the same thing as I said, the shared entities are not leaked. So from the applications perspective, what we need is, we need some values which are associated with a particular life cycle. Okay. If a request comes in your microservice and it's propagating through every microservice, you need some values to be just inside that transaction only. It should not leak outside it. So these are some sort of request scope values, which can be used with the context API in Golang. So it's a kind of official thing which they have made. I'll talk about the context API in brief. Cancellation signals. Okay. So it was the same thing. Since I know that this person has canceled, has booked an Uber for me, but this person doesn't know. Okay. So if he has done the work, he could say that, okay, I've done the work, he acknowledged it, and I can propagate that to him. Okay, so there's some sort of cancellation I'm saying to him, just cancel the thing what you are doing. Okay, same happens in the application as well. I mean, if a request is coming and I started some asynchronous work for the IO operation or any operation I started, okay, request got cancelled from the front end side. So I don't need to perform any operations right now. So I should be able to tell all the async operations that just hold on, just cancel your work. I don't need your result from it. Okay, this is a major thing, which is, I mean, for which the Go context is used. Okay, just to make timeouts and don't unnecessarily process things. And if you, I'm not here to make any comparison to JS, but it's very difficult in JS. You have to maintain special workers and special things to just watch that some asynchronous operations is going on. And to have a synchronous nature between asynchronous things is very tough. Okay, so it's kind of inbuilt in Go because they have thought of this previously on, because they took the pain points of all the languages and then have made Go. Okay. Deadlines and timeouts, as I said. I mean, for example, if I maybe I said that do this work, I book an Uber within 10 seconds. If you are not able to do, don't do that. And I said the same thing to this person. And maybe after 10 seconds, they just got to know that I don't have to do anything. So he just didn't do it. Okay. So these are kinds of deadlines and timeouts which we can use in applications. Alright, so context API in Go was released in 1.7. So it's kind of concurrency pattern. I mean, in their blog, they have stated that Go context API is just a concurrency pattern. It's a new, sort of a unique way to handle concurrency in your programs. Okay, so context general, since, okay, so context would be shared through Go routines because this is mostly related to asynchronous works. Okay, so if you are managing some Go routines and maintaining a communication between them, then it's a concurrency pattern. All right. So in brief, Go context API is a concurrency pattern for Go. All right. This is a very formal definition which is on their website, that a context carries a deadline, cancellation signal, and request scope values across API boundaries. So what API boundary means is it's should be flowing across your API boundaries in between the life cycle of what your transaction of what your request is going through, and it is just a sort of constructed into that chain only. It should not be leaked into your application anywhere. Okay, it should remain where it wants to go and should end, I mean, after that transaction or the life cycle. Oh, and this is a very important thing, that it's by default a safe thing if you can pass context in the multiple Go routines. So we have the wait groups and the sync mutex inside the context, so you won't get any errors if you are using for multiple Go routines. All right, so this is a very basic thing of what the interface context look like. So there are particularly four things inside this. First is the done. This is a very basic channel which just tells you that the context has been cancelled or done. For both the things, this thing returns a value. All right. If this channel is giving you a value, that means the context has ended. Maybe forcefully or maybe it has done its work. All right. Second one is the error, which gives you an error if something has happened. All right. Deadline and the value. Deadline tells you how much time is remaining to end that context. Okay, if I'll tell you how we set times and deadlines to a context, and we can actually in between your program you can check whether the time, how much time is left. So this is very useful in case, for example, you need to do a work which takes 10 seconds. Okay, just a random figure. We don't need 10 seconds to do any work. So since you have a good computation, so 10 seconds are remaining. Okay, and 10 seconds of work is needed, and from my deadline I got to manage, just 5 seconds are remaining to close that call. So I cannot do that work. Even if I start that work, it won't be completed. Okay, if it's asynchronous work, synchronous work. Okay, so that kind of things can be achieved with deadline. And the value is the request scope values which I talked about. So you can actually pass values inside a context and can use that. So this value is used here. And this is kind of very debating topic of value. I'll tell why it's being very much in discussion around the gophers around the world. So I'll tell that. Okay. Then comes the derived context. I mean, before jumping to derived context, let's see Okay, so I knew about context. I assume like I'm a stand-up comedian and I made some reference. I passed it to him. So I passed it to all of you. Then you use that context to some of your friends. Okay, that's how something in stand-up comedy propagates. The jokes are propagated like this. Since you, maybe the third or fourth circle friends know about that context. So you are able to decipher the memes which are coming from the stand-up comedians just because you know the context. And it's also that you have not heard that context in front of you. You have it has been propagated to you. All right. So that's kind of derived context. And the same thing we have in the Go context API. You can actually derive context from a parent context and pass it to another people. And once that parent cancels the context, every context inside it would be canceled. Okay. So that's how this tree works. It starts from the root and propagates to its children. A parent can cancel the context of children, but a children cannot cancel the context of it. Okay. All right. So how you make a derived context? So there are three things which we need to take care of. Broadly three things. There are many more functions which you can use. So I will talk about three things. First is the background. Since if you think like for the main handler, when your request enters your Go program, you don't have any context there. First, you have to create a context. Okay. So to create a context, it's sort of mandatory. You have a context initialization. And for that, you have to do context.background. Okay. I'll show in the code in the next few slides on how it's being done. But yeah, you have to get that root element of the context. So it's done through the background. So context.backgrounds just give you a nil context. It does not have anything to it, but it just have a reference pointer that this is a context from which more things can be derived. All right. And an interesting thing is that if you look, so the HTTP request which we have in Go, it has by default context in it. All right. So if request, we can actually have that from request.context. And if you cancel that request.context, so that the next operations which are being performed can automatically be canceled using that context. So they have actually inbuilt the context API into the request model of the HTTP, right? So yeah, so background is typically used in main and entering test. Probably you won't use it in any inner functions. It's just for the top level boundary where we use this background just to derive the other context from it. All right. With cancel. Okay. So this is sort of interesting and used popularly in the Go world. Yeah. So what it does is it will give you a copy of a context with a cancel method, which you can explicitly call. Okay. To derive it from a context. And you said that this is a cancelable context, which I can cancel. Okay. So once I get the cancel function, so when we call context.withCancel on a context, we have to give a parent context to derive any context. So if I say context.withCancel and in the parameters, a parent context, I'll get context and a cancel function. Okay. I can use cancel function anytime. So I'll pass that context into my further functions. Okay. And whenever I call this cancel outside, all those contexts would propagate some values. I'll tell what values would be propagated. They'll use that same done channel to just say that this has been done. Okay. I don't think any one of you is getting right now because it's kind of theoretical right now, but I'll show you the code, then you'll see how it's actually being done. But yeah, that's the theory that we have with cancel, and another one is with timeout. Okay. You can also derive a context, and while deriving, you can actually pass a time that after this, my context should be canceled. Okay. So this is sort of, we are enforcing, but we are not explicitly calling the cancel function. Also, you can call the cancel function on the timeout as well. Okay.
So both of them with cancel and with timeout are forced cancellation, right?
No, so basically, with cancel is a post one, but for a timeout, it's something like you are giving a timeout, we are enforcing it that after 10 seconds you should cancel. But with timeout, we can actually cancel in between as well. So these are things to propagate some data into the flow where you don't have to control from outside. You can actually use this to timeout stuff inside your work. Okay, and you can use the cancel as well. I mean, the whole purpose of the context is to do two things: to propagate cancellation signals and to propagate request for balance. It's the two purpose of the context, which is being written and used everywhere.
So the wait timeout will cancel it if I set it to 10, it will cancel by 10, but I can use cancel to cancel it before 10 also.
Yeah.
It just gives a signal.
Then
you have to catch it.
Yeah. So basically, it cancels the context and it will give you a signal that this context has been cancelled. And in your functions, you can actually listen to that and do the stuff.
I mean,
you
can fire an event.
Yeah, it just fires an event. Okay. So the done channel, so that will just fire your value that this context has been done or cancelled. It's like that. So kind of I'm going to do a live demo, but not exactly. So I won't do the code right now. I've prepared a snippet just to save me from the live coding because I don't know what can go wrong. I mean, anyone have any doubts still here? Just a random thing, because we can have an open discussion on this. Even I am not good at it. Anyone?
You told that we have 10 seconds, but we can finish in 5 seconds. So it's all in the
game. Sorry?
You told that 10 seconds works, we can finish in 5 seconds. How can you finish using deadline?
You cannot finish it using deadline. You know that you cannot do, so you can cancel it. Yeah. So this sort of you are proactively doing things. Since you know that you're going to do in 5 seconds and the work is of 10 seconds, you know from the deadline that you have just 5 seconds. So you just don't do that work. It's, if you have the time, you can do. So these things are used when you have very high intensive computations going around. I mean, yeah. So it's not in very general web servers which we create. For that, you can obviously have these request for values and the cancellation of asynchronous. But these deadlines and timeouts could be used, but they are mostly used when you have very high volume data going on inside your web servers.
I hope we'll be able All right.
Do? Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I'll do.
Even I cannot see. What happens when we connect laptop to our Android TV? Is it normal?
I think you can use the scale mode.
I don't know about the scale mode.
The scaling mode and settings. You go on preferences, change your display.
Okay.
Go run the displays. Yeah, it's good now. Thanks.
I hope here it is. Yeah, this one.
Are you able to see in the end? The last guy? Sorry? Present.
One more.
All right. So This is the, I have two examples to show. So the first one is, I'm using this result channel to just propagate stuff. And so, okay. So this is the context which I used, dot with cancel. So this with cancel needs to be derived from something. So I've passed it a context or background. So it's a sort of mandatory thing. Since you want to derive something, you should have a parent to derive from. Right. So I derived it from here. I start a guru team and pass it the context in the result. Okay. I wait for 3 seconds and I'll just cancel that context which I passed. And I'm waiting for the result. I hope everyone is familiar with the Go code. Is anyone new to Go? Anyone? I mean, I can brief up. Okay, correct. So you have not done any Go code before, or you know about the syntax? Okay, so we are importing some packages. These are the internal packages which we have in Go. Okay, we'll be using context right now, which is the main main focus should be. All right, this is a time packet. This is an FMT. So this is the main function. Okay, which I would be running to execute this program. This is how we make a channel. This is a syntax on how we make a channel. So it's, we are making a channel. Okay, channel is sort of a pipeline where you can transfer stuff and send and receive from both the ends. We can have a bi side channel. What do we say? Bidirectional. Yeah, bidirectional channels and unidirectional as well. Okay. This is, we define the type. What type of data would be transferred inside that pipeline? All right. So we do that and we context.withCancel is sort of a function which we can use. And we have to pass a context to it. Okay. So context.background actually creates a empty context for you which don't have anything inside it. Alright. We pass it to this. We derive context and cancel. This cancel is the function. Alright. And Go is used to make a function as a Go routine. Okay. So these are processed on multiple Go routines and sort of asynchronous nature and the concurrent nature which we have in Go. All right, which I would get away from the topic if I get more into this Go routine stuff. But I assume it's sort of an asynchronous operation right now. I passed two things, CTX and the result. And this is, so your program will hold here. Okay, so this also returns a channel for you. Okay, when you do time dot after this, so it's actually a channel which is waiting that I should get a value, and it would be waiting for 3 seconds. Until that, the execution will be here. It won't be go down from here. All right. And then I cancel, use this function, and I cancel the context. All right. Here, I am again waiting for the result. So this result, which I made a channel. So this is also a channel. This is also a channel. Okay. This is a implicit channel, which we have in time. And this is being explicitly made. Okay. So I again wait for the result. If the code is zero, I set the call is complete. I'll move it down. All right. So if the code is zero, I set the call is complete, else it has been cancelled explicitly. All right. So if I go to this see perform function, we have context, which I was passing, and this channel, which have the integer type inside. All right. Performing task one, and then again I go to select. This is some sort of switch case, and it would wait actually, since for both the cases I have used that I should wait. It won't finish this program until I get either this or either this. All right. Yeah. So here I wait for 10 seconds and then say that performing second task and return zero that I have successfully executed the two tasks. And if I get the done, so when I call the cancel, this done would receive a value. All right. Then I get to know that this has been canceled explicitly. So I'll just put one into the result, and which means the call has been canceled explicitly. All right. Anyone till here who is not able to understand the code? I can go again. I mean, you guys. I mean, feel free to say, I mean, since you don't know Go, it's fine.
Alright. Anyone? It's all good till here? Alright. I'll execute this one. Okay. So I'll again go to the code. So what it does is it starts this go routine, which would take 10 seconds to perform its second task. Okay. After 3 seconds, what happens is I started the cancellation. Okay. This cancellation was automatically propagated here. Since I have this context passed to this function and it was listening to this, after 3 seconds, this result was a result of this function and it propagated to this side and it said the call is canceled. All right, let's try if I don't put this cancel. Sorry, but it will give me error. Can anyone tell? Will take 10 cancellation started. Okay, I didn't remove that FMT line, print line. Performing task 2 call complete. Okay, what I missed is this line. So probably it said that cancellation was started. So if you see, if I didn't make this cancel call, it actually took 10 seconds to perform this second task and gave a value of 0 to this and it said call complete if you see in the console. Ignore this line because I logged it as a value. Alright. So are you getting sense of how context is propagated and how you can cancel stuff and listen to its cancellation in every the child function? Okay. This can be done to multiple go routines. I mean, you can pass the same context to 100 go routines and it will cancel efficiently that time as well. Okay. And also, if I derived a context and passed to This function, if further pass this context to multiple ones, they'll also have the same context and we can actually, from just to this function, we can cancel all the functions which are down. Okay. We need to see what to cancel. It will just give you a sort of decision signal that, okay, it's just informing you that the context has been canceled and you can use that to do anything. It's totally up to you how to you want to handle that stuff. All right. All right, this is kind of more verbose. Yeah. So here I am creating a timeout. So it's 3 seconds of timeout. I right now have it. Deadline is what is the current time and I'm adding 10 seconds to it. All right, that's the deadline right now. And this is the timeout of 3 seconds. Okay, I took an example of time to deadline. Okay.
It's a timeout in
10 seconds. Okay, I'll show from the code. We'll get to understand that by it. Okay. Since here you have the timeout context, which I'm taking it. Okay. I have this cancel function as well, but I'm not including right now. You will have the cancel function here. And if you go, you don't want to use the thing which you are getting from the function. You can just use this underscore. Okay. For those guys, since they don't. Yeah. So with context, I just pass this context.background and this timeout, which I had declared above and initialized as well. Okay. I created this cancel context, okay, with a cancel function. And this is just the parent stuff I'm passing to this. And we have this deadline context and doing the same stuff and just doing that deadline. All right. And okay, I'll first show that this function. Okay. So in this function, I'm using the context and getting the deadline out of it. How much time is being given for that context to be canceled automatically. All right. This name, I'm just having this value, which I'll pass to every context, which I would be transferring to this function. I'm using this name parameter to extract the value. This is the key. So the context.value is a map. You have key and value pairs inside. I am just starting this function. And if
the deadline is okay, I'll say that it will expire in that much amount, in that much seconds, and else it has no deadline. This is a very basic code right now, and I'm just, it will be, for every second, it will be processing this stuff.
Okay. Above. I need to, yeah.
So basically, context.binValue will also give you a derived context. Okay. So it's sort of, it won't be deriving. It's a wrapper on the existing context which you have. Okay. You took the context, you added the value, and it's the same context, but inside it, it's sort of, it wraps up the value upon it and will just give you. So I made a timeout context, and these are the key value pairs, there's the string one, and these are the context.
Okay. After that, what I have done is I am waiting for the timeout context to just return that it has been ended. Okay. And I just cancel the context, and I wait for the cancel context. So as soon as I'll cancel, this would return. Okay. And the cancel context has been canceled. Then I wait for the deadline context to be done. All right. So I'll run this code. Okay. All right. Let's start from over. It says, so okay, I started three Go routines, three asynchronous operations. Okay. One is the cancel context, deadline context, and the timeout context. All right. Are you able to see, or should I shift this side? It's fine. Okay. So cancel context says has no deadline. Okay. So it's because this deadline function will only return value for the timeout and the deadline. Okay, since we have no time in this cancel context, it does not know, it has no deadline to it. Okay. Then again, cancel context, for every second it's going to run. Okay. So it do. And after this, it says the canceling the cancel context. How does it do that? We are waiting for the timeout context to be done. All right. So timeout was done after 3 seconds. So after 3 seconds, we started this log and canceled the function. Okay. So after 3 seconds, this happened, and it says the cancel context has been canceled. Okay. After doing that, it will again keep on going until this deadline context has not been done. Okay. Since we canceled this, we got this value, but we are still waiting for this deadline to be done. Okay. And it say, similarly goes on. And once we have this deadline context has been canceled in the end, that means we have executed our this deadline context. Now, probably if you see, I have this context.background here. What if I pass this timeout context to this context.background? If I used any of these contexts to this, what would happen? Okay. Yeah. Anyone?
That also gets terminated.
Yeah, exactly. If I cancel any of these, it will automatically would get canceled. So that's how these derived contexts work inside. Okay. Coming to your point, different.
If you pass it to with background element, right? So then that context will also get canceled, right? The parent as well as the.
Okay. See, if I actually had this context.background outside this, and I actually could do something from it, like got the context with cancel context from this context.background in the top, and I then pass the context to all of these. Okay. And if I call the cancel on the parent ones, then these would be signal that your parent has been canceled.
Yeah, the parent gets canceled and the child.
Yeah, child. It's sort of a tree. If you cut any at any point, the down tree will automatically get signal that the parent has cancelled the context.
So is there a way that I just cancel the siblings, all the children, but not the parent?
Not the parent. No, not possible. Because the parent is informing everyone.
Okay.
I mean, you cancel the stuff on the parent. Yeah, that's not possible. But what would be the use case of that? I mean, okay. Maybe we could achieve that, but it's not in the context API.
Create a dummy node.
Yeah.
If you don't want to cancel the parent, create a dummy node and attach the same.
Yeah, we can do that as well.
Once you have time out context or then, why is it printing that down?
Which one? This one?
Yeah, why did you put time out context on?
Yeah, once this is done.
This is done, then it could print that the time out context has been cancelled.
I have not printed any where that time out context has been cancelled. Sorry.
So in the last, like it's 10 seconds or 9 seconds, they're saying that the timeout context will expire at this time. So once it has been done, why is it printing this?
Timeout. What's the value for this timeout? It's 10:49, and when was it cancelled? Probably we have 10:40. And okay, so it has the same value. It has the same deadline value in it. Probably it's just showing the value.
I guess that's supposed to be only from that as opposed to context.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, probably if you see the both time values are still the same, which is in the deadline. But yeah, exactly. The go routine is continuously working. It does not have sort of garbage collected that stuff.
Yes, return.
Yeah, probably we can. So my purpose was to ensure that these deadlines, you can see that stuff. It's totally up to you how do you want to handle that. You can return the stuff even within 1 second of the deadline and even after doing that deadline. So it's totally up to you. Yeah. That's the whole thing why people don't like context. Yeah, but probably every go routine won't be doing asynchronous operation.
But how to keep a tab of this channel?
Probably, I mean, if you want to receive something from channel, you have to wait for it in any case. It's going to be synchronous within the function. Probably you can use deadlines and timeouts there if you don't want to. You just get. No, you just get the value from it. But huh, in any case, you have to receive those values. I mean, you cannot do. Okay, so if you don't have the context, you cannot do anything. In any case, you need the context and extract the values. So you can actually have. Okay, so if I say that you pass a request ID to your context, okay, and you want to do that if this is the request ID, then do this. Okay, so you have to pass that to the context, though it's an should be a parameter outside the context. It should request IDs should not be inside the context when you are controlling the situation. Okay, so there's a very minute difference between informing and controlling. Okay, you should not use context.value for controlling stuff. Okay, you should use for informing stuff. Okay, once you are doing the controlling part, then it should not be inside the context. Okay, context is some sort of life scoped thing inside the transaction. It should be so it's a value which should be available to everything. Everything should be informed from it. It should not be like that. One function is being advantageous for that value. So that's not the purpose of context. Context is to propagate the stuff throughout your tree. All right. Yeah, coming to your point, yeah, we have to either use the dot value or that, and we have to wait for it.
So the tag on done channel has to be if we go to pass the context.
Yeah, that's the hard part. I get that, but yeah. That's what the discussions are around. Okay. Yeah, that's the whole discussion which is around the GoFest community. If you are on the Slack channel, on the general, on maybe the Belgium one, they are continuously discussing about this GoFMT. There's a change log podcast. They also discuss the same thing. So it's kind of debating topic on this since there are very more things that you won't like. One is this and few others I'll tell.
I just have 5 minutes. Okay.
As I said, it's just about the informing, not controlling. Okay. I'll just give me 5 minutes. Yeah. Okay. So have anyone of you heard about distributed tracing? Okay. So for those who don't know, distributed tracing, so when you have a distributed system and multiple microservices going around and you want to tap into the system and observe what calls are being going from one microservice to other, what resources they are accessing, and what was the bottleneck and where was the bottleneck. So for all these things, you do a distributed tracing. You sort of log everything, every communication you log, and from log you pick up the useful data. All right. Okay, so once your request enters into a web server, it has a request ID or a trace ID. Many companies use that. And that trace ID would be propagated to whole every transaction which is going on. All right. So for a particular lifecycle of a request, you need trace ID to be present in every function. Okay. So that's where you would use context.value. You'll pass something in the context.value, which is about informing the stuff. And even if it's not present in the context.api, you should not have any burden inside your function. Your function should not say that if this ID is present, do this. It's not about that. You just need that and you are logging that. Even if it's not present in the log, that's fine. It should not crash your function. So context.value should be used very carefully. It's not passing the control parameter. It's about the operational parameters. Yeah, it should never be used for the values that are not created and destroyed during the lifetime. It's totally about what your life cycle wants, and you should not pass the values inside the context. It should be used outside the life cycle. It should be created at the start point. It should be destroyed in the end. Okay. That's the whole ideology which people follow around the context. And this has also been stated in the Go blogs. Okay. Okay. It separates the core computation parameter from the operation parameters. As I said, if you want to do some controlling, your function definition can have other parameters to do that. It's the same thing just in a different manner, that you can actually differentiate your code on the basis that if this function have a context inside it and a value is passing by, then it's not an important value to control stuff. It's just about informing. Okay. Optimize resource usage. As I said, if you are making a DB connections or anything, you can actually cancel it and you don't have to. I mean, if that asynchronous operation goes on and you don't need that result, there are many times in JS, it happens almost all the time. You started a request from the front end side and the user closed the browser. You don't need that data anymore. And the asynchronous operation keeps going on because it has been started and there is no way to cancel it. Okay. Criticism is that there is no acknowledgement of cancellation. This was coined by Dave Chain or Dave Channel. What do you say? So probably he was saying that there is no acknowledgement for cancellation, but people have built libraries around it. So that was the one criticism which came. And apart from that, since you are avoiding the static type checks, okay, if you pass something to context and extracting from the other side, it's an interface context.value. You are not statically checking anything. So you are actually prone to more errors on the runtime if that happens. Okay. Other thing is it bloats your function signature. I mean, there was times people were saying you have to pass context in every function. Why should I? I mean, if that's the use case, just make it available in the HTTP package, which they do, But for example, for any other stuff, people were saying that include context in everything. If you want to say, because the Google guideline says that pass the context as the first parameter in the function. Okay. And this has been used in the Google from quite a long time and they're still using it. But that kind of make your function signature much more bigger and unnecessary. Okay, so if your one function have this context and does not need the context, but it's a child need, you have to pass the context to this and then to this. So it's kind of bloating function signature, but yeah, that's the hard part of this. Meta practices is the same as the context this has to be passed. That's what other gophers are being doing around the world. And a function that is never request specific may use this. So these are context.background and context.todo are sort of empty things. So it don't do anything. But yeah, if you have to just maintain that consistency throughout your function, you just need these two functions. Okay. .todo is nothing, it's just empty, but it tells you like logically that you should do something inside this. Yeah, it's for a purpose. It's just they both returns the nil context. Okay, contexts are immutable, so you can actually pass them to any goroutines. They won't be altered anytime. Context should always be flowing. Okay, I'm ending this right now. Can anyone tell me why it should be flowing through your whole life cycle? Anyone?
It needs to go everywhere down to the last usage.
Yeah. One very important point is that which I have not mentioned, and it's very important that you should not store context anywhere. Okay, not inside a struct, not as a global variable, nowhere. Okay, because if you store a context, it's totally opposite for what context is used. Context should not be stored anywhere because it's a request scope thing in a lifecycle, and when a lifecycle is destroyed, context should not be present anymore. If it's present, your memory will be leaked. Okay, so that's why it's sort of a river which keeps flowing and won't stay at a single point. Okay, that's the whole crux, and that's the ideology which people follow around this context. Yeah. Thank you. Any questions? And we can.
What is the scope of context? Is it application, or we can use the context across application, the timeouts and everything?
Across application, I mean, you want to pass the across microservices, probably not. You should not pass the context because it's bounded to a single application, logically. And why would you pass a context to other application? I mean, just to transfer the trace ID or the request ID.
Probably.
Okay, so, I mean, the one Go web server has a context inside it. Once you actually initialize it, the garbage collector knows that this context has been initialized. The other microservice won't know about that thing. But if you somewhere mismanage the context, your garbage collector is there to handle the stuff. But the other microservice won't be able to do it. But yeah, obviously you can do that. But yeah, you have to very optimizely do that stuff. You should be able to. So if you follow these guidelines, then it's fine to pass the context. If you are actually probably having the correct use of context and you're not leaking it, then it's fine.
In production use cases, is the usage of context such that for every subsystem you would have your own sort of base, the way there is background. Mm-hmm. Background can't be cancelled. So you might want it for per subsystem, one thing that you would define above background, and then that is what you pass on every.
Mm-hmm.
Is that how it's used in production use cases?
Yeah, more or less, yeah, exactly. So, and many organizations don't use this. Those who use it, they use the way you are telling, but yeah, many don't do because they think that context is not needed. They can actually create their own channels to do this stuff if they want.
If they ever want to log a certain function without stack traces or anything, they just want to log in their log file as what sequence of events got me here.
Mm-hmm.
How do they do that without
context? With context.
Without context.
Okay. Without context. I mean, probably. If you are having an HTTP request, okay, that request have context inside it. They don't have to do that explicitly. So inside the HTTP.request, you can add values, you propagate that sort of thing. And if you can obviously create a new channel, you can give it values to it. But in any case, you have to maintain that thing that the value would be received and you should be acknowledged back that this has been done. In case of logging, we don't need any acknowledgement. But yeah, we can of course use the channels and the worker things to do that. Probably context is inside the same thing. Yeah.
So I have seen a pattern where people use context.value set the global dependencies like connection and global. Mm-hmm. Is that a good practice?
No, not because probably I read few blogs and everyone stated that these logger and these things should not be inside the market. Yeah.
So it is okay in the
context.
Every time when a request comes, the request will already have a context. You create one more context with value.
Mm-hmm.
Put the request ID which you have generated, application has generated, and a trace ID or username, whatever you want,
mm-hmm.
and then pass it along. And whenever you log,
yeah, you can extract that value. It will be in every context which is passed. Yeah, but we can have the discussion after talk because we are running short of time.
We have a break after the talk. So if you have any questions, again, please.
So please, your mic is working, right?
This one?
No, on the laptop we have a mic, I don't see the showing up.
I think it's there, it's working probably.
Okay.
You just check the volume. Hello, is it working? Is it working?
Introduce yourself with time and then start off.
Nothing is coming. Other board? Other one?
Yeah, go to the.
Yes.
We are on a different display.
That's what I was thinking.
Can you go to your display?
Display is how?
What voice are you on?
Ubuntu.
Ubuntu. Sorry. Just go to your system settings. Display settings.
Yeah. Okay. We should.
Yes, we just started 2 minutes. Hold on.
That just closed. Yeah, it's a game.
Just minimize this. Here.
Minimize. Okay, this one.
Yeah. Do you have a
so much stuff?
No, don't worry about it, man. Sorry, go help. Don't need this. Do you know where your settings are? How to get to settings?
It should be here.
What is this?
The applications. Click here.
Is there a mirror display? Do you see a mirror?
Apply. Yeah, keep going.
Okay, where's your browser? Yeah.
Good. Zoom link, I just need to open the Zoom link.
You've already joined, right?
It just got closed when I pressed this key.
Oh, sorry. Sorry, don't worry.
It's not opening again for some reason. Okay, it's open, I think.
Yeah, it is working. It is on. It is on here.
Okay. Check on. Display on.
I can see what's taking.
Display? Display is on here.
Yeah, you have to share. You can share. This is share.
Share screen.
Share the whole desktop.
Whichever desktop. That good? Yeah.
All right, guys, we'll start the second talk. This talk is by Yeshwanth.
Hello, guys.
Just prepare 10 minutes or so. You go behind and I'll give you a clue of 10.
Okay. Hello, guys. I'm Yeshwanth. And let's start with getting started with gRPC. It's one of the CNCF's incubating project. And I'm pretty new to gRPC, and in my current project, I'm working with TTRPC, which is a like scaled down version of gRPC. I was interested in this, giving this topic. So that's why I'm here. Today, we'll be going through a bit about myself, gRPC intro, why gRPC is rising, benefits, protocol purpose, basics, and demo. Small demo, this small, it's too small. Where do I go from here?
So I like to present. That's pretty obvious. And my Twitter handler and Gopher Slack handler and my LinkedIn profiles are here. So you can connect to me over there. And I'm working with Containerity project, and I'm also a co-organizer for the Cloud Native Bangalore Meetup group. And I'm pretty much cloud native freak. I'm involved with, like, I like cloud native stuff, so I'm jumping from one project to another. So let's start. First of all, how many of you are familiar with gRPC? Okay. So how many of you use it in your production? Okay, half of them. Fine. How many of you are familiar with the, like, concepts but not with the, you know, coding part? Cool. So gRPC is nothing but a RPC. Remote procedure call is a powerful technique for constructing distributed client server based applications. So the term client server is a core thing here. So when you have a client, you have a server, and you call a process from the server, from the client, which is existing in a server, which will respond to you with the result. So that's RPC, that's what RPC is. And so there are two things here. So IDL, so why do we need an IDL? So it's interface definition language. So anybody has any idea why do we need IDL?
Because both parties can agree on it.
Huh?
So both parties can agree on it.
Who?
Both parties can agree on it.
Yeah, that's a valid point, because a lot of people will be working in a lot of languages, and you don't find, like, you can't force others to work in the same language as you do, right? So in that case, while using RPC framework, you need an intermediate, you know, standard. So that's what an IDL is, and RPC is what we just talked about. So gRPC, I used to think, like, it's Go or remote procedure call, but it's not. Its full form is gRPC remote control protocol. So I used to think it was Go, G for Go. And it's a framework and library. It's a framework. We'll see, like, when we get to the demo part, we'll see how good of a framework it is. So it's also the eighth step in you know, getting cloud native for, you know, organizations and all. So as I told, I'm a cloud native freak. So we'll get to the architecture without further ado. So this is what it is. Like, this is gRPC server, which might be in any language. And there are stubs over there. Stubs are nothing but objects defined on your client side to access your server with gRPC. So that's what it essentially is. So we have Ruby, Android, and C++. So there are multiple languages support for gRPC. We'll get to that in a bit. So it can be done in any manner. Like, this is a RPC, nothing much, nothing major. So short Q&As. I just started, but, like, what's short Q&As, right? So, but you see, let's S for only A. So there's just one question. So why gRPC is rising? So can anybody tell me why gRPC is rising?
There's less data to be transferred.
Yep. Besides that, REST is getting old also. It's also one of the things.
It has support for many languages. So
it has support for many languages, and intercommunication is quite easy, and it supports protocol buffers as well, which are really fast and compact, and it's also secure, if I'm not wrong. It uses binary format, right? So in other words, why should I use gRPC? That's what we just talked about. So modern applications are quite demanding. So that's what this picture is about. Like, I was reading in some previous presentation, and I thought it might look good. So maintainability, scalability, high availability, fault tolerance, microservices, automation. So all these kind of things we do need to, most of us try to include in our projects, right? So now whatever we do, and every part of the you know, whatever we do, we try to expose that part somehow. Like, even if I'm using, you know, a platform, right? So we try to expose each individual module as an API or some kind of endpoint which can be accessed with. So in case I have a troubleshoot, I'll just go with that module, not the entire thing, right? So with that in mind, like, how many REST APIs do you think you need to implement when you go with a major website or something? So that's quite a lot, and it's quite demanding as well. So in that case, gRPC would be quite helpful. So benefits of gRPC is it uses HTTP 2, which has a lot of it has a lot of advantages, which I'm not going to cover because I'm sticking to gRPC. And it can use protocol buffer, and it uses protocol buffers as default, but it can use alternatives and multi-language support and various connection options that we'll get to in a minute. So languages, these are a few languages I mentioned, not all. I think web something is also there, and a few others if I'm not wrong. So this many languages that it does support right now, and I think it might keep growing. So protocol buffers. So can anybody tell me what protocol buffers are? Okay.
So way to serialize the data.
Yeah. It's also kind of considered ideal for using RPCs with gRPC. So this is what a sample thing looks like. So everything is considered a message, and you have multiple values under that. And the numbers on the right side, it should be unique within that range, and that also defines your number of bytes allotted to you. Like the greater the number, the higher the bytes. So let's start with the gRPC basics. So the one I just told you, like about 4 slides back, if I'm not wrong. Various connection options, the one I just mentioned there. So in the CNCF path also, you saw this message streaming, right? So it's not just an RPC which you just use it once. Like there are various ways you can connect to it. So 4 of them are there. Unary RPC, which where you just send a request and get a response. That's just one time thing. And server streaming RPC, like you send a request and the server keeps streaming to you. You know, there may be a deadline or something like that. So it keeps streaming to you till some certain condition is met. So then client streaming RPC. This is where you client keeps sending requests, and after all the requests are arrived on the server side, and then it will give you a response. So the bidirectional is two-way communication. No matter what, just keeps communicating. So steps for gRPCing, like how do you get started with gRPC, right? So this is the way that I used in this session, and this is the way you should do it, because you need to define a .proto and you need to extract your pv.go file if you're using Go. And since this is a Golang meetup, I need to use Go. So first thing is define a service in a .proto file. So that we'll see. Generate a server and client code using the protocol buffer compiler. So I'll be using some examples which are already there when you download the gRPC, and we'll get to that in a bit. Use the Go RPC gRPC API to write a simple client and server for your service. So we're just going to do a hello world thing in some time. Short Q&A. Why did I put this? Does anybody have any idea why did I put this one? I don't remember. So first we'll get through a few questions. Fine. So RPC, it uses a standardization, and that standardization here in this example would be protobuffers. So protobuffers, we just saw the format how it is, like the standard of protobuffers. And besides protobuffers, we can use other alternatives also, but in this example we're sticking with that. And we're going to use unary thing. Unary stream, yeah, something like that. So not the other three, because this is getting started one, I'm sticking to the basic ones. Any doubts? Like I might forget some questions. So anybody has any questions so far? I think not. So want to see it work? We'll just get the... So this is installation. I've already installed the gRPC and proto compiler, so which generates the pb file for me. First thing is getting gRPC, and then getting my proto gen go, and I'm just adding it to the path. That's it.
So this is the sample service we're gonna build. Okay. So this is the part you're gonna focus on. We need to focus on. This is the protocol, dot protocol, which I mentioned. I need to increase this one probably. Yeah. So even more. Okay. Okay. So the first thing is syntax equals to proto 3. So there are two types of proto protos. One is proto 3 and one is proto 2. Since this is the latest one and it supports a lot of features, we're going to the proto 3, and those are not, you know, compatible. Like sometimes you might get compatibility issues if you are using proto 3 as a server and client side proto 2 or something like that. So package hello world, because that's a folder name, and service because I just went through the proto buffers standard, right? Like how you write the proto buffers. So that in that case, I only mentioned the message, and there needs to be a server as well, because server is the place you send your things, send your like you have your code, right? So this is having two functions, two messages to be clear. Hello request, which has a string, and then hello reply, which has a string again, and a service which is mentioning that it's an RPC, say hello, it takes hello request and sends hello reply. So that's what it essentially means, nothing else. So for this one, we need to generate the .pb.go file. So in that case, this is the command I'd use. Since I'm using examples, everything's already there. Because when I fetch, just a minute. So workspace go is my go path, and from there google.golang.org/gRPC is the path I have downloaded the gRPC, and under that itself there'll be some examples given to us. So we'll just get there and we'll see what examples do we have. So we have mainly two examples, hello world and root guide. So I think both have documentation in the official website. We'll be going through the hello world. So we have four folders here. We'll see that over here. So greeter client, a greeter server, hello world, mock hello world. Forget the mock hello world and focus on hello world right now. So hello world, we have protocol, and we use the protocol as a compiler for generating the .pb files, and we use that. Like we didn't use it because everything is already there, and with that you have a proto pb.go file as well. So this is the fold, this is the file that was generated by proto for me, and you can see quite a lot of stuff is here. We'll see gRPC is imported, and bit proto is imported, contexts are imported. So package is hello world. As you see, the hello world is the folder that we have, and a lot of constants, structs, hello request. We do remember hello request, right? So the name is here, and besides that, there are three other things that are, you know, generated by product for us. And we have quite a lot of stuff here. We're not going to go through everything. First, so greeter server is here. So register greeter server. That's what registers our server. So we'll see this in the server. So this is under greeter server. That's a folder name, and under that we have one main go file. So there you can see, you know, besides having gRPC, we need to implement our functions, right, our functions to have, like, to contact gRPC, right? So in that case, I need to have some functions, right? So that functions I imported as PB, this one. And I used some port and exposed it. And this is a server file. So here we have register, pb.register.
Did I change it?
Yeah. Register greeter server that we just saw here. This one. So these are the, gRPC essentially does one thing, nothing but calls local functions, which gets response from remote functions. Like remote functions are called as local functions. So in that case, I need to have local functions implemented, and server also should have the same methods implemented. So in that case, this thing kind of standardizes it, because it generates everything for me. I don't have to write this much of code, right? So we'll see here. We have some error and error handling things, and TCP port will be opened, and we can set up authorization for this also. I'm not going to cover that because it's getting started. Even I have to study authorization part. Then besides that, we'll get to the client part. Here also, it's using the same PB as Hello World directory, and we have quite a lot of stuff here because address, like, this is client, right? So it needs to have an address. So in this case, I'm just using localhost. I'm not in some network, and I'm not using I'm not connecting to some remote server, right? So in that case, it will be localhost, and the port I just mentioned in the server dot, like, the server file, and connection will be established, and we can okay this. So as you can see, let's just say hello, right? So that's what we find here. Say hello. Yeah. This is the service. This is a gRPC function which gets our request from the server. So client will get this response, and it will show it to us. Like, we'll see in a minute. Okay. So I only have one file in the greeter underscore server. So I'm going to run that, which will open a port for me and set up a gRPC server. So it doesn't output anything because I didn't put any print functions over there. So we'll open another terminal. And we'll try running the client. So this is the response I got, and server also received it. See, so Golang Mangalore is what I've sent to the server, and it responded to me, hello, like, hello Golang Mangalore. It just took the response and sent the, like, it took the input and sent the response. So that's what gRPC does. Okay. So the as I mentioned, the three steps, okay? One thing is define the proto.proto file, then generate the pb.go file, then implement the functions in your client code, and implement the function in the server code. Then you can access server with the client. And this is pretty easy for developers, so that you don't have to build any REST APIs or something like that, which can be quite, like, boring also. And it's quite costly also. So where do I go from here? I have a few resources, like nothing but the official websites, because they're quite long and everything almost is there. And besides that, there are a few blogs that you can check out. So that's my presentation, and I think it's any questions I'd like to take, although I might not be able to answer. You can answer each other. So questions, please. Hello. Yep.
So what happens is we have to, so let's say pay my API, there's more arguments in one of the calls, right? Now every client has to update the protocol, copy the protocol, and generate a new client interval.
So as long as your functions, as long as
the problem there is, that's fine actually. The problem is the old, I'm not sure, old client can copy the new server.
Old client. So if you're talking about the Proto 3 and Proto 2, it might be an issue. As long as you don't mess with the definitions, it's perfectly fine.
Because I think using this gRPC is a massive
Because you need
tracing
to ensure people be able to define who can read something, you need to be able to. There are many other things that you have to take care of where a message bus has to come in picture. But if you have a message bus, how can somebody already having their architecture start using them? I was just about to ask the question regarding the scale. In general, you write for application code in a way to have people suppose client is getting upgraded by RPC calls.
That depends on what I
mean. All the items that you don't really follow. But if you have a contract saying, hey, you shouldn't pay for it, then you want to follow.
Stuck with rest or something else.
How do you use the data? Do you data in the message or written error
option. It can be done either ways, right? It can be done either ways.
So suppose in the promise server something went wrong, or it is a pure request validation error, do you use the Go's default error object to return that or use something in the message?
You always string again go to the good string combination good and then give the back that you can
do. So the also this error object, but you can use start as error or usually gRPC itself has errors. You can wrap your error values into variables or a structure of error as long as the client itself probably could start the error code as well. Like I've also seen people using special structures that help you because you can create any problem.
The way I see creating own error struct and marching it with JSON to the error. I don't know if it is very practical or not. Very much more. The string I was using struct to string so that I can pass the error object back in the
other. Well, what is that? It means you need a struct, partially the JSON, and then partially the JSON into the string protocol, and then that you have to do the double marching.
Is that it? Any other questions? So and you can find my presentation over here, and that's it.
So what's coming up next is a break. We have a half-hour break. We have some more questions. So you can continue this meeting with the host next. And we have one more time to talk later on at the literature study by Aman from yes. So yeah, so another thing I would like to tell you all is that from this meetup onwards we are trying to see if there are individuals who would like to pitch or give a 2 minute pitch about their property and their openings. Within this community. And if you are also someone who is looking out for a job, or if you are good experience in that, feel free to also speak about yourself. So the way we go about that is I will be somewhere over here. In case you are interested in speaking for the minute, just talk to me and just give me the info. So what the reason for that is we want to know how many people are there. After the end of the session today, which should be about 30 after another shot, I invite all of you to come and look at your pitch. So we'll restrict it to 2 minutes, but if there are more people, we'll probably keep it 1 minute. Yeah, so that's the info I have. I think the stats are there. Yes.
Could you speak louder? I can't hear
you.
How many clients can be handled by a server? Well, that depends on the CPU of the where the server is run by.
So they put the family host in
bandwidth. Network bandwidth. So we'll discuss offline now. We'll discuss offline. I'll come there.
Ganesh, so we are taking a break now and we are going to start again at 12:30.
Yeah, sure, no problem. I will join after that. Yeah.
It okay if the lights are on or if you want to
but Oh, hi. So we'll start. So I'm going to talk about debugging using Dell. So I'll quickly introduce myself. My name is Aman. I've been working at dgRPC Labs for 6 months now. Recently started our India team in Golang. dgRPC is state-of-the-art graph database. We are a distributed graph database company. We're building graph database from scratch, and the whole database is written in Go. We all the there was some part of the code that was in C before. Now everything is written in Go. If you want to know more about dgRPC or want to join, do come talk to me and or send an email to us. We are happy to talk to you guys. I'm just saving 2 minutes. All right. So just a quick question: how many people have already used Dell on VS Code or command line? Okay, few. That's nice. Okay, so I don't know. My goal here is to help you start debugging using Dell. Dell is very easy to use from command line. You can also use it from VS Code. Both work perfectly fine. Golang also have used a few. VS Code works perfectly fine. There's no need to go to Golang. But if you feel free, you can feel free to use Golang as well. My focus in this talk, I'll start with VS Code. But rest of the talk, I'll focus on using command line because that's much easier if you're doing more complex debugging. But all the things that we can do in command line, you can also do using VS Code. It's not difficult at all. Okay, so Dell, Go language compiles to assembly. So when you compile your Go program, it gives you assembly code. And because it gives you assembly code, you can use any debugger that will work for C++ because the way debugger works, and I'll explain at the end of my talk here how debugger works, and this statement makes a lot more sense. So there was a time in Go community when there was no debugger, and we used to use GDB, and it used to work okay, but people are not very happy with it. And again, we'll talk about this a little bit at the end. GDB doesn't work well with Go programs simply because it doesn't recognize the lot of interesting ideas that Go has, like Go routines, and then the stack size can increase dynamically. The stack size for a routine is not fixed. It starts with like 8 KB and grow to 16 KB and then in MBs, right? So these things are not recognized by GDB. And again, you'll understand this a little better at the end of my talk. So Dell is specifically designed for Go, and this is line which I really like. It is there on the GitHub page. Chances are if you're using a debugger, things aren't going your way. And with that in mind, Dell should stay out of your way as much as possible. And Dell is designed with this philosophy in mind. It's so much easier to use. You don't even know you're using like a debugger, debugging your code. So that's just a quick intro to Dell. Its installation is pretty straightforward. Just go get minus use the path, and you have the binary available on your PC to use it. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna actually use simple programs to help you see how you can debug using Dell. So we'll start with debugging in VS Code. Feel free to ask if you have any questions. I have tendency to go fast sometimes, so stop me and ask questions. Okay, so let's start with VS Code. Okay, so this is a small program that I wrote. To install the debugger in VS Code, the only thing you have to do is there's a Go language plugin for VS Code. You install that plugin, and everything just comes with it. And the plugin, once the plugin is installed, it will install all the dependencies that it needs. For example, need Dell. Dell needs like other 10 dependencies, and those dependencies are going to need 10 more. It will install the whole tree. And as soon as you install the plugin and the dependencies of the plugin, you have all of this ready to use. Okay, so this is a small program. What it does is just do a binary search. and the binding search code is in the same package, different file. So what we'll do is we'll try to debug this binary search code. This it's a perfectly fine code. There's no problem with it. We'll still debug it for the sake of it. Okay. So when you're debugging in VS Code, you need to tell VS Code what you're trying to debug, right? So I'm gonna delete this file so we can recreate this file. Okay, so what you do is you just press F5, and when you press F5, this one is happy. It shouldn't be happy. One second. Okay, it's just working without it. Anyway, what I'll do is to be able to debug in VS Code, you have to create a launcher.json file, font size. Okay. All right. So you have to create this launcher.json file in the .vs code folder. So you see my project starts here after desktop. Bug is the name of my folder. This is where all the code I have written is inside the bug folder. So you can create a .vs code folder there and then write launcher.json file. This is the structure.json file, the launcher.json, which has the information as to what we're going to debug and how we're going to debug. And most of the information comes with it. Just specify a random code, doesn't matter. You can specify a random code, doesn't matter. This program is the parameter which is actually important. This is where I'm telling it whatever the root of the workspace is, which in my case is bug. And then hello is the folder, and there's a file called main.co, which is what I'm trying to debug. So when I press F5, debug this program. Right. So just that's all I need to tell VS Code. On your computer, if you press F5, actually open and we generate this file for you. It's not doing for me for some reason because I've already done it, I think. Even if I delete it, it still is able to figure it out. So we'll debug this code now. And it's very simple. If you have used debugger in Python or any other languages, it's very simple, similar to that. So what I'm going to do is, I'm just gonna say when you come here, stop. You see this red button, right? So whenever the code will come here, it'll stop, and I can debug my code going forward, right? And that's the debugger window. So you have to be here to be able to debug. And then it does say no configuration. So let's say it complains. Okay. So as soon as you press this green button, say start debugging, it'll run your code until the breakpoint. Has anyone not used a debugger in their life in any language? So everyone kind of is familiar with the basic idea of debugger. Okay. Cool. So it stops here, and then I have three choices generally: step, next, and continue. Step means I can go inside the function that's gonna be called. Next means step over the function, so don't go inside the function, just execute the whole line and then go to the next line. And continue means go to the next breakpoint. Right? This is very important to understand a debugger. Right? So step, what is step? Whatever. So in this case, we go inside whichever is the function there in this line. We'll see what the function is. Or next is? Yes. Execute the whole line and then go to the next line. Right? Whatever that means. In this case, execute the whole line 12 and go to the next line. In this case, it's no next line. And the continue means? Next breakpoint. So start, keep continuing until you come across another breakpoint, and that's where you stop. Right, so in this case, so you can use, so there are buttons. Yeah, we see this button on the right, top button. So the first button is continue. The next button is step over, which is next. Same. This button is step into, which is step. I've never used the other two buttons. Step out. Yeah, step out means you will go out. So you are executing inside a function. You'll execute the whole function and come out. Yeah, but I don't generally use it. I just do a next myself. But anyway, so we go inside. I'll press step into. So I'm going to go inside the binary search and see how my binary search is working, right? So I press step into. So in this case, because there was this, there was cr::con.i2a, it's computing that first and then executing binary search. So I'm just going to come out of that. So I'm gonna say step over where I am. So you can see the call spec here. Call spec essentially sequence of function that I've called over time. So it starts somewhere inside runtime. I was in meetup main, and now it's in line number 12. Right? And as soon as I go inside, so I'm going to press step into again. And now it gets inside binary search. You can see it says meetup main and then binary search. Right? So these are all the goroutines. I'm going to show you this. So currently there are four goroutines running. Three are pause and one is pause, which is the one that we are debugging. This makes sense, right? And then in main.binary, this is the pause step right now. So it starts somewhere runtime.main and then went inside main.main and then main.binary search. This is where this is how I know where I'm currently executing or debugging my code. Right? Make sense? Can we just move on? So everyone knows binary search. The shortcut for next is F10, so I'm just going to continue using F10. So you can see on here, there are all the variables, local variables, and the values of local variables. So binary search, so we are looking for value V, which is right now 2, right? And then the array is AR, which is... ...4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14. That's a six slice. And you're looking for we're looking for 2 in this array, right? And then the begin and end that I pass is 0 and 6, right? So end is exclusive, but it doesn't, that's how my search works, doesn't matter. So I'm just saying begin is, so in this case, begin is smaller than end, this is going to be false, which is what's going to happen. It just jumped out of it. I'm pressing F10, which is next, right? And then I'm computing mid comes out to be 3, that's this one. And then I'm checking if it is equal, which is not. 2 is not equal to 3, and 2 is less than 3, so it's going to go inside this if. So again, I'm going to press F10, and then we are here, right? And I want to continue debugging, right? So what do I press?
Next.
Anyone else? Any other ideas? Huh? Okay, so what happens if I press step into? Huh? It'll go inside by itself. If I press next, what will happen? Right, so you go to the next line, the whole binary search is actually done executing now if you press next, right? So it depends on if you figure out what the problem is, then you kind of move on. If you have not, then you want to go in, so it's essentially a recursion, right? And it's a sequence of calls, you want to go inside. You actually see the calls like growing here, so I'm going to go inside. So I'm going to press step into, I'm going to go inside binary search, and you see the call stack grows, right? There's one more binary search call that I just made. And I can just keep doing this. So now the whole thing will change now, right? Meaning my array will remain same because I pass the same array again. The V's will remain the same because I pass the same value V. Okay, V and R here does not change. Begin and mid are going to be different, right? So begin is 0 because I again same value begin, but end was 6 before or 3 now, right? Because we pass mid for the value of end. And if you want to kind of go back one more, so you want to go down your stack and see what happened before, you can actually click here and you can see the environment that was there in that particular call. Okay? But we are executing in here, so we cannot execute that. Make sense? This is very simple. If you have seen debugger, there's nothing new here. If you have not seen, feel free to ask questions. Okay, where are we? We are executing here. Again, I can go inside to make sure my binary search continues. This is weird. So I'm going to press step over one more time, and then I'm going inside again. So the call step goes again one more time. Right? Just keep going. So, and then when you're done, just press continue, and I can execute. And they stop here again because I keep calling them you. So my first binary search is complete. You probably see a print here. So 2 it doesn't exist in the binary in my array. So it's false here. So this is how we can debug in VS Code. You can also so we'll talk about how to do it from the command line. I'm not sure you can do it from VS Code. You think there's a console?
Yeah,
this one?
Yeah.
We will not support this one. I can say like print begin. It says EOF. It's not happy. It's something else.
Yeah. Oh, I don't know how to do that.
I think same. Maybe send. It should ask for semicolon. That's just not true.
Yeah.
It's something.
Yeah.
Dell supports print. Yeah, something else. Cool. So this is how you debug a main program, a main function. And when I say main function, it's like a whole tree below it, right? Because main is where the entry of the program is. There could be like millions of lines of code below main, which you, can eventually reach to, right? Generally, what happens when you're writing code, you'll actually end up writing a test for your function that you just wrote. And then you'll run your test and you go, this test is not working. And you're not going to figure out why my test is not working, what's the issue with the test. So in that case, you can debug your test. And VS Code will let you do that. So I've done a test for my binary search. So that's my test. Same test, which we, same parameter that I pass in the main, there's nothing new here. And then I can see the button there, right? Debug test. You can press debug test and debug the test. I'm going to put a breakpoint first, and then we'll debug the test. Same story, there's nothing new that we're going to do here. So I press debug test, and then I take my program stops at 11 because that's where I put the breakpoint. And then I can go inside. If I'm not happy with this line of the code, I can go step into. And then I'm now again inside binary search. I have the whole environment available to me. I can see what the values of variables are and things like that. Right? And I can debug the whole thing. So I'll just step over. Same thing. I'm gonna stop doing this. Okay. Cool. And then there's one more feature, conditional breakpoint. So we'll also see quickly what that is. Right, so I'll go back to my main program again and we'll debug our main program with a conditional breakpoint. So, but I'm doing this loop, I'm saying iterate over 2 to 16, 2, 3, 4, 16, and then do a binary search, look for the element I in my array, right? And let's say I know my binary search generally works, doesn't work for let's say 10. I equal to 10, it doesn't work. So I'm gonna stop, I'm gonna do a debug on binary search when I is 10. Otherwise, I don't wanna debug at all. I don't care about it. If you put a breakpoint like this, then you stop every time it comes to this line, which is I equal to 2, and then I equal to 3, and then 4, then 5, and 6. And you have to kind of press 10 buttons to reach to I equal to 10. So what you do is you simply right click here and then you say edit breakpoint and then you can put an expression here. Expression generally would be what you put inside an if. And it cannot, you cannot call functions, like all that complexity is not allowed for now. So I'll say I is equal to 10. So only stop when I is equal to 10. You can also do hit count with things. You can specify if you hit this line 10 times, then stop. So it seems you can do that here. For now, I'm just gonna say expression is I equal to 10. And if I run my program, I go to my debug console and I say debug. It'll keep going and it'll stop when I is 10. You can see I is 10. Okay, so this is something called conditional breakpoint. So you can use this in scenarios where there's a loop or there's a recursion, and you can say stop at this point when certain condition is satisfied. Just sometimes could be very useful. All right, so this is all I actually do VS Code. We'll actually do a lot more interesting debugging using command line. Everything that I'm gonna do going forward, you can totally do from VS Code. Just it's easier to do it from the command line. There's like three commands totally you have to remember. Cool. So we'll move on to debugging Dell. So we'll do the same thing, but we'll do it from the command line this time, right? So we'll debug our main function using Dell debug. We'll also debug the test using Dell test, and we'll look at all these commands that are available for you. Any questions so far? Okay, so I've already installed Dell. It's in my Go code bin. And then I want to debug the main program. Right? And then my main program is in Hello. Okay. So this is a local path. So there are two paths that Dell keeps track of. One is the standard library path, where the standard library of Go is, the Go path, and then the path that we specify here, which could be a local, which could be a standard library, could also be a Go path library. So in this case, it's a local path. We'll also do a debugging on a package that's available in GoPath, and then you can also debug the standard library Go code. There's no difference whatsoever. I can literally say, I think, like debug FMT or something. But FMT doesn't have main, so you can also only debug the main ones. Let's see if I do put happens. It says cannot debug a non-main package. I'll say hello because hello has main. So it gets it. So this is the dev command prompt. Debugging hasn't started yet. It's only the dev has started. And then you can do a lot of stuff here. So first thing you want to do is put a breakpoint. So you want to say, before I run my program, I'm going to put a breakpoint so that when I run my program, it stops somewhere. So we'll do the same thing. We'll stop, put a breakpoint on line number 12 of main.go. So you simply say, so I'll just quickly show you help. So again, do not have to remember anything. Help has everything. So how do you put a breakpoint? There's a break command. How do you see the breakpoint? There's a breakpoint command. We'll actually like try all the commands here to kind of see how everything works. The conditional breakpoint, the continue. You can see all the goroutine. The current goroutine, you can see all the goroutine. You can see the help. And then you can see all the local variables that you see on the left side of VS Code. Next, on does something interesting, and then you can print, evaluate an expression using print, and so on. So we'll start with all these commands one at a time. So what I want to do first, okay, so we'll do breakpoints first. So I'm going to say breakpoint, the short. So the command is break, the alias is B, you can just use B, you can also use break, doesn't matter. So I'll say break and it's main.go and line number is 12. This is called something called line spec. There's more interesting thing you could do here. Like you can specify what function to stop on, things like that. I generally use line numbers, it's easier to use that. So once I do this, saying that I set a breakpoint in main.main at line number 12, right? And then you want to run your program. So it says continue. Right, start running my program. The short for continue C. Right, remember three things: the next step and continue. Step, next, and continue. So we just now use these three very often. Right, so same as VS Code. And I'm on line number 12. You see that arrow? That's how I know this is the line that's executing correctly. And I can just say, so I'm gonna go inside and see what's going on. So I'm gonna say S. S stands for step. That's there. So if I press step, what's gonna happen? It'll go inside, and in this case, did go inside? Yeah, it's going inside I2A again. I'm gonna press next again. So okay, if I don't write any command and press enter, it's gonna execute the last command that I enter, which in this case is next. I'm gonna press enter, and now it's just in terms of the next one, right? And if I'm inside again, I'm gonna do next. Actually, not step. Swing step. So I'm going to just press enter and enter for a while. So it comes out of this back here. And now I'm going to do binary search. So I'm going to press step again. So now we're inside binary search and I'm going to do next. You can type locals. There's no local right now. So there's only one variable right now, which is mate, and the value of mate is one. You can also say print. Print is for p is for print, and then print begin. You can say print end. You can also say print AR. All of that works here. You can also say print AR of 3. It shows you the fourth value in the slice. Very simple thing. If you forget anything, you always can look at the help, which is H, and then all of it is independent. Right? And then you just say next, and then you keep doing this until. So I'm pressing enter now because I just want to keep doing next.
Can I call any Go function?
No, not really, no. Not call Go function. The problem with that is Go compiles, and there's no one to. So if you give debugger a function, Go function, it cannot execute that function because it what the Delve is going to do is, hey, this is expression, can you evaluate this expression, right? And when it evaluates the expression, it only can evaluate the variables or the combination of variables, things that it has, it can interpret itself. Maybe tomorrow Delve will have the functionality of interpreting the functions. It doesn't have that the functionality already, right? So idea here is that Delve is not executing that code, interpreting this code. Do you see the difference? Why can you not execute this code? I mean, when it's like ultimately everything executes on CPU, so there, no doubts there. But the difference in execution versus interpreting the code,
the debugger is not the parent process.
Sure, but that's like, so what? I can still, like, if it was Python, I could probably do that. Right? If it was like Scala, I can probably do that.
You could do that in compiled languages also.
No.
Running the function.
Right, but you always interpret those functions in a compiled language in a debugger. You don't compile that code and run that code. That's generally difficult to do.
And the code path also changes when you run the function. But actually, half of the code path flows.
Yeah, right. So Delve is adding that functionality. I think this functionality is experimentally available, I think. Yeah, this is some progress in that.
Write anything. I'm just saying I write
a 20
print element.
Right, yeah. Then it has to figure out where I play. You're just writing one line, but for the computer,
but
it's
Java
like 100 lines that it has to execute. Huh?
Java I'm able to do.
Right, because Java, JVM gives you that functionality. So it's not that it's not possible here, it's just the functionality is not available right now. It's just going to be slightly more challenging.
Right? Not even in IDE, I can do it.
No, of course not.
The Delve is chosen to not implement.
Not chosen, just like it's a more complex function. It will take time.
Is there any other thing I can do? I know in LLTB you can do it for sure. I don't know about Go, but for Swift programs for sure. No, Java you can do it, but for Go I must. I don't know if LLTB would allow
it. I don't know if anyone has tried to look at it. So people have tried building interpreter for Go, like a shell where you can run like Go. You can write one line of code. Yeah, it's very difficult. So what those interpreters actually do behind the scene, they take that one line, write all the code around it, the whole main function will be there, execute the main function, and give you the results. So the Go has to be compiled to be able to make sense out of it. There are no interpreters for Go. That's the challenge here. So that's why when you say variable, so okay, ask me this question again at the end of the talk. I'm not going to this right now, but I'll tell you how the does it print something? How it actually exists? What does Delve do behind the scene? Okay, coming back. So we are debugging our main function, and then we use our different commands inside Delve, which is next, step, locals, continue, and things like that, right?
So,
do you want me to continue doing this or skip this now? We are okay. Makes sense. Make sense?
One question. What
yes.
is the PC colon? Is that the
that's a program pump.
The one that's in the CPU, that one.
Right, yeah.
So
the operating system, not
this is pointing to the function that is being
I think this is pointing to where the code is gonna execute next.
Next.
That's what program counter is, right? That's the definition of program counter. Okay, yeah. So pick a debugger and we'll compare. Like for example, let's pick GDB, right? So because Go compiles to assembly, you know what? We'll discuss this at the end of the talk again, because if I go into this will be like a long conversation. I'm gonna avoid that right now. And I'll tell you exactly how all these things happen behind the scene. We'll actually do a lot of interesting stuff. But my focus first is to understand how we work, and then we'll get into it. So these two questions are pending, okay? Cool. Okay, so we did breakpoints. Condition is very similar. You can say, so you put a breakpoint. Okay, let me look at the syntax, I don't remember. This is a basic help condition.
the syntax is the condition, the name of the breakpoint, and the Boolean expression. Right? So how do you know the name of the breakpoint? So you list all the breakpoints. So again, go to help. This is a command that print out info for active breakpoints. So I'm going to use pp to print out all the breakpoints that I have currently. So I'm going to print. So we have only one breakpoint, breakpoint one, which is on line number 12. What I want to do is I want to put a condition on this line saying that only stop if the value of I is 10. So I'll use the same syntax that we had, which is this one. So condition breakpoint number one, and my condition is I equal to 10. And if I say BP, it should show up. Yeah. BP is only listing all the breakpoints, saying that, hey, there's a breakpoint number one, which is on line number 12 in main.code. And the condition for that is I has to be 10. So if I say continue now, I'll stop there again. And if I print I, it should be 10. Right, so very similar to VS Code, and again, I don't think it's complex. It's pretty straightforward. It'll take you like one day or like half day to get used to these BPP, S, and C, and these are the commands. I generally use. Once you get used to it, you don't have to use VS Code anymore. So so I press continue. It's exited, and I can press Control D to exit the del command prompt. So this is how we do the debugging of main programs. Sorry. The del debug, you can do the same thing with del test. So we have tests in hello. I'm going to say del. Okay. So if you're debugging a program like binary search or very simple programs or a test, you probably like, there's no need. I'll give you an example why you would debug from, why it's sometimes it's difficult to debug from VS Code. Yeah. And since I joined dgraph is a distributed graph database, so we run like seven services to be able to run a database, and I need to figure out a debugger. Like, I need to debug like a small thing in there, and that is a super useful there.
One possibility is that you don't have access to the source code, but I give you the binary. It'll be tough for them, but
binary has a lot of information, so it will be slightly challenging. You can still do it.
But still, on a remote machine, let's just say, it doesn't need to be a functional machine, it could be a remote machine, not your laptop. Still, you can actually debug the source code. With all the fancy breakpoints.
Yeah, so we'll actually talk about remote debugging. So, there's a process running remotely, and we'll debug it from our desktop, our computer. The binary is there, the program is there, but we have the code, and we'll run a debugger using that code. Debug the process that is running. Good. We'll run del test, and we'll say your question is answered. And you see how it is very useful in distributed debugging. Okay. We'll try that.
Huh?
Yeah. So the binary actually has a lot of information. So you can kind of do some of it, not a lot of it. I'll show you all the stuff that goes into the binary at the end. Okay, so now this one is debugging the test inside .hello, right? And then I'll add a breakpoint again in my test. I'll say line number 11 in search test.go. There's a breakpoint. I can say continue. We'll run all the tests and stop when the breakpoint hits. And again, same story after. There's no difference whatsoever. Okay? I'm not going to go into this. Thing to remember is your del binary, and then you choose if you're running a test or a main program, and then you specify what package am I debugging. That's it. And then, you ever forget something, just help. It's right there. You don't have to like Google anything. You just say del help, and then just all the commands are there. So debug is compiled, beginning debugging main package, and then test is compiled, test binary, beginning debugging program. So anything, every time you forget a syntax, and then you can say, what about, how do I debug the test? You can say minus help there. And all the, so del test and the package, and that flag will be specified in case you want to compile it, your program is ready.
Cool. So we did breakpoints, we did condition. I'll also show you clear and clear all. So we'll do a test debugging again, and I'll set up a by the way, control R works here, control R reverse search. People who knows what reverse search is. Yeah. So you can just say, hey, I'm looking for breakpoint in main.go. Breakpoint in main.go, yeah. So this works really amazing. Then you can also do the up down thing that you do on terminal. So we'll show you the last command that you have gone before and the whole street. Okay, so we want to clear, so I'll set up a breakpoint or test. So and I continue, and then that's where we are. And then you can look at the breakpoints, and then you can say clear breakpoint one. I don't want breakpoint one. So breakpoint one is clear, it's gone. And then there's no breakpoint anymore. These breakpoints exist for debugging purposes. So Dell adds these breakpoints to runtime so that your program doesn't just exit and Dell is like gone, doesn't have handle on the program anymore. So Dell adds these breakpoints. Make sense? So we can clear breakpoints. Let's see what clear all does. Clear all deletes multiple breakpoints. You can also delete multiple breakpoints if you like. So delete meaning the breakpoint is gone, it won't stop on that line anymore. We already know stack, no next, no continue. Look into stack now. This is interesting. So I let the breakpoint again in case my program kind of stops. And then we look at the stack. So this is the stack of current goroutine. Right, there could be multiple goroutines and each routine will have its own stack. So again, say something with the piece on VS Code on this side, right? So this is one goroutine which is up here currently debugging. And then you can see it starts from somewhere and it goes it. Then it's called the testing material is called. And then the test binding search is called. That's how my stack is. I can also look at the goroutine, the current one. So this is my. This is called goroutine 20, which is running on thread number 2. Threads are essentially OS threads, which are mapped to the processor, the underlying processor. Okay, if you don't understand it, it's not okay. Okay, so this is the runtime. This is where the user program is running. This is the current goroutine that we are debugging. We'll also see how we can switch goroutines and you're debugging one and then switch to another one and like go back to the first one and so on. So you can do that. Okay, you can say go routines. So I did go routine last time without the S, now I'm doing with the S. Now it'll show me all the go routines that are currently out there. So the one that we are doing is the star one, which is this one, and then the runtime is running other go routines for like GC or for like 100 other things that we can type this. And then testing is also in one routine. You can see all the routines. If you're running a complex program, there's a good chance you're running multiple routines of yourself. We'll see all of those routines there, and we'll see how we can switch between these routines. So the stack is there. Let's see what help up does. So up moves the current frame up. So let's look at our stack again. And then we can look at the local variables. There's no local variables right now. So what I can do is, what I see right now is what I can, what this function can see. So let's say there's a function called here, right? And I'm gonna see what the value of a is this before I call this function. I can go to this frame and see what's going on inside there. You can say up, and now this is inside the testing package, and then this FFT was called, and you can actually print what T was. And if this was some complex struct that was there, you can also print other things. And then you can go back to one frame down where we started. I'll go up again once more, and then I'll print a stack, and same stack, and then I can go down. So back to where we started. Right, so this is useful to see what my stack time is, and then what the values of variables were in my like call stack below, if you go down the stack. What does frame do? Oh, it sets the current frame and execute command on different frame. Yeah, so I can probably, so this is my stack.
and then I can say frame one or two. So now I can directly jump to the frame number two, some two elements down the stack. And then this is the runtime code. We shouldn't look at this. So I can just go back up again, and then I can print stuff. And like, so again, we'll see it later more when we have more complex debugging, that there could be sequence of function call, and then moving up down, up and down the frame actually sometimes is very useful. And Lucas, you already saw, print, you already saw, I don't remember what set does. Sorry. It changes the value of variables. So you can say B is 2, but I want the B to be 3 and see how my program behaves. So you can say, so we'll go back to our frame 0, and then this is where we are. And we can say, I can say set, let's try this. I'll try this. AR is equal to slice of n, and I only want 4 and 6. Yeah, see, you can also only set the primitive variables up, so you cannot set the slice. So you can say, like, set, there's no variable I see here, unfortunately. I cannot change the type either, I think. Cannot kind of, but you get the idea, right? That you can set value of a variable. So now the value of a variable will be the new value that you set, and then you can continue debugging with this new value. This will generally be useful when you kind of figure out the solution, but you're not sure the solution is correct. You kind of modify the variables with the new cost solution, and then see how your program still behaves without actually going back and running your, starting your debugging session. That will be useful then. Again, forget about everything that I said. Only remember that there's a help button that you can click on and type and figure out what each command does. I mean, I looked into all of this yesterday and then I forgot today because there's no need to. And let's see what on does. I thought on was interesting too. On execute the command with a breakpoint. Right. So you can say, so let's say there's a line in your program, and whenever the line executes in the program, you want to see a value of a variable. So you can say on breakpoint one, print the value of V. So whenever the breakpoint one will hit, it'll print the value of V right there. You don't have to always run print to V. So we can actually do this. We go inside binary search, and I'll say, add a breakpoint on line number, add a breakpoint on in search.go and line number 5. It says it's ambiguous. Does this make sense? Why there is an error? I'm sorry? Why are there multiple? Hello, colon only had one subscript. Right. So it searches every, so your main.go, everything that is imported, it knows all about them. Whenever you specify a file, it tries to see if it's an unambiguous file that it can figure out. There are multiple files with the same name, just complain, and then you can just choose one. That simplifies. You can say b close slash search.go and then line number 5 works now. And then I can say, whenever you're on breakpoint 3, just print the value of begin. I want to see what begin is. Right? And I can say continue. And you see, begin is 0 at this point. You can say continue again, and begin is 0, and so on. Right? So whenever it hit that, it would hit that breakpoint and it'll print or run the command that you kind of gave to run. Not the go command, it's a del command. I have never used restart and checkpoint. The help says that you can checkpoint a particular state of the program and then continue debugging. And then you can say, hey, I want to kind of go back to this particular state and then continue debugging again. That is what restart checkpoint does. I'm not very sure about this. But if you are debugging again a very complex program and again restarting the session takes time, can use checkpoint, and it's very easy to figure out how to use it. Again, use help. Don't even need to do it. Wait, any questions here? I'll move on otherwise.
So,
Okay, we'll do a graph debugging and we'll see all the complex stuff and we'll like ask the same question. Cool? Yeah. Okay, so we'll do parallel debugging. This is where if you have multiple goroutines and then you want to debug or switch between goroutines, you can do that here. This is a slight trick here, trick in the sense that something doesn't work. Like, so in GD, has anyone done GDB debugging in a multi-threading program? So when you're doing multi-threading debugging in GDB, you can actually switch from one thread to another. So you can move both. So what you can say is, so let's say there's a sequence of instructions, right? This is thread one, this is thread two. You can say execute line one here, and then execute line one here, then execute line two here, then execute line two here, and then three here, three here. You can actually literally construct a whole path in which your program will execute and trace a particular series of instructions that will lead to the bug that you're debugging for. Does that make sense? So you can say one line here, then one line here, then one line here, then one line here. So you can do that in GDB. You cannot do it in Dell. That feature is not available. So be careful, even if you're switching goroutines, doesn't mean it's not the step-by-step debugging in each thread. And I'll explain why that's not possible. It doesn't make sense, that's okay, don't worry about it. Okay, so we'll debug a parallel routine and see how we can switch between routines. So I'm gonna exit this. For exit, you use Control D. I think Q also will work. Okay, so I have one web server. We'll run the web server and then see how life is there. Okay, so what this program does is, it's a very simple web server. The slash ping endpoint that is registered, and whenever I hit slash ping, it call handle ping. And handle ping reads the counter, which I'll talk about in a minute, and then returns that counter to me, so I can see, the client can see what is the value of the counter is. And then counter is just a variable, which is a synchronized variable. It is protected by the lock. That's why it's acquiring a lock before reading the counter. And then there's a go routine that I run here. So this routine runs in parallel, and then it will sleep for half a second, acquire the log, increment the counter, and just keeps doing that enough forever. So essentially, there's one routine that's incrementing the counter every half second, and then there's a web server. These are the two routines that we are be careful of. And we'll debug this now. Okay, so now, what's the command I'm gonna run? Huh? Del? Debug? What is the path? The dot slash. Because we are debugging, so if you are inside a Go path, you can specify the package name, like github.com/a/b. We are not inside Go path, desktop is not my Go path. So we have to specify a local path, which is par in this case. And we are again debugging the main program. So let's run this program so we understand how it behaves and then we'll debug it. So the server is running now, and then I can ask the value of things. It's 17 right now, it's 20, it's keep incrementing. All right, okay. So let's debug it now. So I'll set up a breakpoint in handle ping for now, and then we'll see what goroutines are running. So I'll set up a breakpoint line number. I'll say breakpoint on line number, this is main.go. And line number 60. Big point is set up and I can continue. Now my program is running. Okay, let's look at, why is it stuck there? Is my program running and what's happening right now?
It's a service.
It's a web server, yeah. So it's stuck. I don't see the Dell command prompt and I don't see my program running in some sense. Or is my program still running? What's happening? If, yeah? It is running. What's happening then? What's happening? What is it doing? What is my program doing right now?
Waiting for?
One second. One time. You're saying waiting for four breakpoint.
But
program doesn't wait for four breakpoint. It executes the program and when the breakpoint comes, it kind of stops. It doesn't wait for breakpoint access. Right. So it's stuck on the accept part. When you say TCP connection accept, it's waiting for connections to come. My program is still running. It's not doing anything useful right now. Okay. You can press Control C now if you feel like, and you can actually see where your program is currently stuck. I'm not going to go into this code. But that's the code which says, hey, wait until a new connection comes up. The benefit of this, I can add another breakpoint, like look at the things and so on. So we look at what's going on right now. So there are multiple routines running. This is the one that we started, which does the increment every half second. Okay? And then that's all we really understand. This is probably the one which is on our web server and waiting for the request to come. Okay. So now I'm gonna, so if I do a curl, I'll accept the connection and then start executing the rest of the code. So, okay, let me just do it. Right, so it, now the breakpoint, so it started executing the handle ping code because I hit the slash ping and the client is stuck, right? It's waiting for the response. And now I can see and debug my code and see. So if you look at the goroutines, so again, there are two routines. One is this is where I am handling ping, and there's another one which is this one, which is running our increment counter. Right? So I can see the stack of current routine, which is running the main or the handle ping. You can see start on server HTTP, it's inside the net HTTP, and then eventually call my handler. Right? That's my call stack. You can see start on everything starts on the. Now I can also switch to another goroutine, which is goroutine number 5, and see what's going on in goroutine number 5. So, so now I'm switched to goroutine number 5 from 35. You can see 35 is the one we're executing before. So now I'm in goroutine number 5. You can look at the stack of goroutine number 5. So we'll start from increment counter. That's the function that we executed. It's reset. Go increment counter. That's where it starts, and then sleeping in time. Right? And we mostly be sleeping because the code sleeping is half a second and code execution is like, I don't know, 1 millisecond. Right? So if I say next here, what will happen? Oh, I can show you the code, so it can be easier for you. So either I'll stop somewhere, then I press next. Where will I stop? Do you want me to go back to the command line? So currently this coroutine where I am right now is stuck on time.c. That's where it's waiting. Okay. So if I press next, yeah, this is the code that does time.sleep. So it's coming out of time.sleep. So now, as soon as I press next, because I was on the increment counter goroutine, I executed one line of code there in the top stack. But on the other side, the other goroutine got executed and I got response by 153. This makes sense. I'll do it one more time so you can see it. I'll actually just keep pressing next here for a second. Okay, this makes, so I kept going up the stack after executing the function, and now I'm in increment the goroutine which is executing increment counter, and this is the client where I'm going to execute it. Right? Make sense? Oh, so I'll do it one more time so you can see it. So I'm still stuck here, and then I'm going to send this code, and this code will get stuck because the code that is accepting the connection cannot execute because we are stuck on a breakpoint. So I'll see, I have two goroutines, the one that I care about, which is 5 and 34. As soon as I can switch again, or I can press next, if I press next, they go one step further. And this is still waiting, okay? Because it cannot execute while I'm inside log.log, because counter cannot be accessed by two routines at the same time. Even if I press next, I'll still, this will not finish. As soon as we press next again, this will finish and we'll move on. Okay. Because these two are executing parallelly, they'll keep executing. There's nothing that stops them kind of make progress.
except the breakpoint in the current. So current will only execute one line. The other one can potentially execute multiple lines. Right? This is different than how GDB works, and I'll explain to you why it is different. But you can still switch between goroutines and see, I don't debug this goroutine, not this one, and then so on. You can do the follow-up. If you have questions, I can go through this one more time. This was confusing. Who understood? One person? So I'll go through this one more time. Yes? You have to say yes, at least. Okay, cool. So I will do this one more time. So again, we have two routines running. Again, the ones that we care about. One is our web server, which is accepting connections and running our handler and so on. That's one goroutine. And it can potentially execute multiple goroutines for each request. We're only sending one request right now. So one request will translate to one goroutine. Another request will translate to another goroutine. So because I'm only getting one request, we only create one goroutine from the web server. So that's one. The other one is our increment counter loop, which is this loop. This loop is sleeping half a second and incrementing the counter safely. That's all this loop. Okay, so two goroutines. And now we are currently debugging the increment counter goroutine, right? So let's say send another request. This now my program cannot make progress because it's in the pause mode right now, right? No code can execute until I say next or continue or something of that, right? So this is not except that, hey, I see there's somebody listening on the port 8080, but I'm not able to communicate to it. So I'm going to wait for the response to come back. That's what the client is going to think. This is our client. Okay, so when it's, so now I'm on line number 25, and I'm gonna, if I press next, right? So this goroutine will execute how many steps, how many lines? That's a very simple question. It's not a tricky question. So if I press next here, it'll execute. So it'll execute the one line, the sleep line, right? Very simple, it's nothing fancy happening. But the other goroutine can execute as many lines as it wants. There is no rule there, unless the program stops, right? So when goroutines execute, this shuffling happens on a thread, right? So that's why other one can execute as many. We don't know how many lines will actually execute. So if I press next, this one actually finished the other goroutine. Okay. And so you can still switch to the old goroutine if you want. So I'll start the client again. If you say, I can just press continue and it'll stop here because we have a breakpoint. Makes a little more sense. The thing to remember is that there are multiple goroutines. You can choose which goroutine you want to debug. You can switch to that goroutine and start debugging that by adding breakpoints to it, by playing. That's the basic idea that you have to really remember. Okay, I'm going to move on. You can do all the cool things that you could do in the previous slide that I showed you, right? I'll show you. Okay, so we are stuck here, right? And yeah. I'm gonna switch to switch goroutines actually. So I'm gonna switch to the increment counter, which is 5, I think. Okay, so now I'm inside increment counter, right? And this one, there's no client, right? Okay, what I'm gonna do is, I'm gonna just do a verbose debugging. So waiting for the server to accept that connection, has an acceptable connection, because there's nothing executing on the server side. That's your answer, right? That's what you're asking?
Can we have only one routine
works? Only one routine you can debug it. When you press next, all the routines can potentially execute, but the one that you're debugging will only execute one line.
So what are
the routines you're debugging? Which is different. And we can really talk about why it's different like that. This is the whole idea how Go works. So you have lots of, okay, we'll do this at the end.
Okay, multi-process debugging. This is what I really wanted to do today. I'm going to take 10 more minutes and then finish. So this is how dgraph works, and this is how it is very helpful for me to use Delve in debugging dgraph. So dgraph has something called Zero, which is a very lightweight service, which is what gives you high level HA, high availability, and the cluster of generic keywords could be more depending on the requirement. Alpha is the one which is essentially a worker, which is a lot of work, which is the high, heavy lifting work done by Alpha. And then they communicate among each other, the cluster, and client can talk to any Alpha, figure out what to do, and run queries, and all this stuff that the database can do. And so most of my PR actually, I see an issue, and then I'm like, I don't know what, because I'm not very familiar with the code base yet. It's only been 6 months. So I'll start debugging the code using Delve and see what part of the code this issue is touching, and then try to figure out how I can find a solution to the problem. I wanted to do this debugging of dgraph. I'm gonna skip it. I'll just show you how to do it to give you an idea as to how you can debug multiple processes together at the same time. See here. So what I want to do is there's a test that fails in my dgraph code. I'm going to run that test, and I'm going to debug that test as well because I want to do this step by step. And then I'm going to run zero, which is my HA service. I'll only run 1.0, simply by my debugging. And then 1 alpha, which is my worker service. Again, I'll only run 1 because if I run 3, it's going to be very difficult to figure out what's going on. Okay, so I'll run 0 first. So this is my zero running. I don't wanna run zero in, so you can actually debug zero by saying zero is generally very simple service. I don't need to debug it. Alpha is the one that I really care about. So I'll debug alpha. So this is the command I use to run dgraph alpha service. Say dgraph is my command. Run the alpha and then some command, some parameters to the alpha. To debug this, the only thing I have to do is, I have to say, instead of this, run Delve, right? And then I want to debug the main program, which is inside this path. I specify the path. And then I want to debug the package github.com/dgraph.io/dgraph. And our main of alpha is inside dgraph, in our root directory. This is the path where the main of alpha resides, right? This is where main.go is. I can show you this quickly. So this is our main file, which is what runs the alpha. This is package main and function. So when I run this file, this is what is going to run my alpha. Alpha is our worker service. Okay, so I'm saying here, okay, run Delve, and I want to debug the main program, and this is the packet that I want to debug. This is in go path, so it doesn't have to be an absolute path. Okay. And then, because I need to pass arguments to it, so I can just say, so there's a syntax here, double hyphen, and everything else that you want to put, that you want to pass to the main program. So all of this, from starting here to here, will be given to the main program as a parameter, and the main program can figure out what to do with it. Everything else is for Delve. So once you do this, now you're gonna go into debugging mode, and Delve command prompt shows up. Now I can say, put a breakpoint in some file that I want to debug. So let's say server.go, and line number 753. So I can say breakpoint. I know it's an EB graph in 753. So it's a breakpoint setup, and I can. What generally I do is I go so these are our tests, and I just pick any test that I can run. So let's say I'm running test transaction basic, and I can say I'll put a breakpoint here, and I'll say debug test. So okay, just realize what I'm doing here. I'm using VS Code debugging to debug my test, which is running separately, right? Then I'm running dgraph, which is one. The zero and the alpha. And alpha is also running in debugging. So I'm running two different two debuggers parallelly, one in VS Code, one in command line. And command line is debugging the dgraph. This one is coming debugging the test. And this test will eventually make a call, HTTP call or gRPC call to alpha to talk to it. And once it makes that call, my debugger will hit the breakpoint and I can debug my alpha and figure out what's going on to that particular call. Does this make sense? So this is how you debug a more complex distributed service. I'll just quickly finish this slide. You can do local and remote debugging very easily. Local debugging, so let's say this process already running. You did not start the service with Dell. Simply say Dell attach and the PID of the service. And then now you're debugging a Go program which is already running. So there's nothing you have to do there. If there's a process running remotely, you have to run this command. This is essentially running a server. And you have to run this server remotely on the remote machine. Once you run this, now you can from local machine connect to this remote server, which will in turn debug the service, the process running on the remote machine. Right? So you can do local debugging. All of this is very easy. The thing to remember here is not the command, that you can very easily do local debugging and remote debugging. And Google how to do remote debugging, you find these two commands and just move on. Now I'll talk about the details that we're talking about. So 5 more minutes, okay? This is the last, this is a really cool part I wanted to cover. So what is a debugger after all? Like, what does debugger do? How do you write a debugger? Right? And the idea is not to write a new debugger, but to understand why debugger works in certain ways. So there are two really interesting things that debugger has to do to be able to debug a program. So one is that's to, so the OS, so when you're running a process, the operating system provides you system calls to say that, hey, stop this process after executing this particular instruction. Or like put a breakpoint to stop this process when this condition is true. So all of these things, when you say breakpoint on this line number, the debugger has to figure out which assembly code line it is, and it'll ask the OS to stop that process when the line hits. That's the one very significant part of debugger is. And I can quickly show you all of this actually happening in real time. So I'm gonna do our debugging of the web server. Let's do the hello, it's easier. And then I'm just gonna run strace on it. Strace, what does it shows you all the system calls that are going to the system, just traps all the calls. Okay. And let's say when I put a breakpoint here. Yeah, okay, I put a breakpoint, didn't find it. Okay. Okay, so when I put this breakpoint, it is somewhere there. Finally, calls is something called predict wait private, which is again system call, which is Delve is doing on our behalf, saying that, hey, I'm running this process, but put a breakpoint in this process at this assembly line code. Right? So this is how debugger does one very significant part of the thing. The other significant part is having the debug info. Right? So why GDB can also debug Go programs and Delve can also debug Go programs? That's because the debuggers don't care where the code is written, what the language code is. There's mapping in the binary which says that the assembly line here is corresponding to the line in the code there. So it only does this mapping of assembly line to the line in the code. And I'll show you this here. There's a lot of information that goes into the okay, so I just built a binary, and now these are ELF format binaries. So I can ask for the debug information using this. So again, doesn't have to remember anything. Just this is for to understand how debuggers actually work. You see, this is where the code is written, the assembly code, and it says, hey, when you press X, go from line number 36 to line number 19 in the file. It actually remembers all this information, and that's how you can debug GD. You can use GDB to debug Go code. You can also use Delve to debug Go code. The difference is, so when you use Delve, so every function, whenever you make a function call, for example, the first thing that Go does is checks if the stack is good enough or not, the size of the stack, right? This is an example. So what the difference in GDB and Delve is, right? So first thing the function call is going to do is to check the stack size is good enough, right? If the stack size is not good enough, it's going to increment the size of the stack and then continue executing the function. This part of the code, if you use DDB, you'll actually see debugging this part of the code as well. While if you're using Delve, Delve knows that this code is not useful for the user to look at. So it's going to skip that code and move on to the more useful part. So that's the difference in GDB and Delve. And because debuggers are pretty smart and using and they use this debugger information, kind of figure out which line of code that is executing CPU translates to which line of code in my Go code. And they can show you that I'm on this line. They also know when you say go to next line, it knows how many assembly instructions you have using this debugger information. Okay. So that's all from my end. Is there a question that is left to answer? You had one question. Any questions? No? Okay, so again, I'll summarize quickly last minute. If you have to debug, I would suggest use command line. It's very easy to use command line. You can always use help. Remember, install Delve and Delve help is there. Go inside the Delve and then ask for help again and so on. And it works really well. You can also do distributed debugging. You can remote debugging, you can do local debugging, attached to an existing process. All of that is pretty easy. Just run one command and you have the Delve command from gRPC. Right? Or you can probably have more discussion. I don't know that today. Right, thank you so much. Thank you.